going to be a course on general relativity, and I request all of you whoever is planning to attend, okay, or taking it for credit, just send me a mail. I'll write down my email address. So just send a mail to this address so that I can keep you on the mailing list. Okay, so that in case there is any change in the plans for the class, I'll inform you by email. Okay, so let me then begin by introducing what is general relativity. What is it that it's it tries to do? Okay. So general relativity is a theory of gravity. Now, of course, we have learned about Newton's theory of gravity, okay, which is based on a very simple law that the force between two point masses is given by the Newton's constant g, m1, m2 over r square, and the direction of the force is along the unit vector along the radial direction. And you also know that it's always attractive. Okay, so you can put a minus sign here just to denote that it's always inwards. However, this law has one flaw, and that is that this describes action at a distance. What does that mean? That imagine that you have two point masses here and here. We move this mass a little bit, then the other one feels the effect instantly, okay, without any time delay. And this we know is inconsistent with the basic principles of special relativity, okay, which says that no signal can ever travel faster than light. Okay. Whereas if Newton's law had really been the correct law of gravity, then we could simply move this point mass. Okay. That effect will be felt by this point mass instantly. And then by appropriately moving this point mass, you could transmit signal to this object over here in zero time. Okay. That would be the instantaneous transmission of information. And that is inconsistent with the general theme of special relativity. Now, we can of course proceed with two different approaches. One, we can say that the Newton's law of gravity is the right one, okay, and special relativity doesn't hold for gravity. On the other hand, we can say that special relativity is the correct principle and Newton's law doesn't hold. And as it turns out, okay, it's Newton's law which is at fault, okay, and that is rectified in general relativity. Now, of course, I mean, we know that Newton's law is not the right one only because we have tests of general relativity. Okay, otherwise, it could have happened that special relativity breaks down for the theory of gravity. Okay, but we know that that's not the case. Okay. Relativity holds, Newton's law breaks down. Now, it's clear that if we want to try to make a generalization of Newton's law, okay, that is consistent with the rules of special relativity, it should satisfy one constraint, and that is that in appropriate limit, it must give us back Newton's law. Because we know that in appropriate limit, Newton's law works very well. Right? That's the guiding principle of determining what gives the law of gravity. So in a sense, Newton to GR is analogous to electrostatics to Maxwell theory. Electrostatics has exactly the same problem as Newton's law, because in electrostatics you have instantaneous Coulomb interaction between two particles far away. And again, if that was the final law, then moving one point charge, you could instantly transmit information to the other point charge. But you know that that is not the correct description, because the correct description is a Maxwell's theory. And in Maxwell's theory, if you move one point charge, the way the information gets transmitted is through electromagnetic wave that takes a finite amount of time. Okay, because you propagate the velocity of light. So at this level, okay, we can say that Newton to GR is like electrostatics to Maxwell. However, it turns out that GR requires a little bit more sophisticated mathematics compared to Maxwell's theory. And this is what is known as a Riemannian geometry.
So, underline
GR is Riemannian geometry. So because of this, what I'll do is that in the first few lectures, I'll try to give an introduction to Riemannian geometry, okay, without any reference of Gramming or anything else. Okay, so in the first few lectures, you will not hear the word gravity. Okay, we'll try to describe what we mean by Riemannian geometry, and as you will see, it's a generalization of the usual Euclidean geometry that we're familiar with. So this is some kind of general idea of okay. So let me begin by outlining the main difference between what we call Euclidean geometry and what we call Riemannian geometry. So let me begin with some basic laws of Euclidean geometry. And that is based on the notion of distance. So take conventional three-dimensional coordinate geometry that you are familiar with. And let's take two points which are infinitesimally close to each other. So take two points. One of which has coordinate x1, x2, x3. And the other one has infinitesimally different coordinate x1 plus dx1, x2 plus dx2, x3 plus dx3. Okay, so two neighboring points. And now we want to calculate the distance between these two points. In Euclidean geometry, the distance between these two points, ds, is given by square root of dx1 square plus dx2. Is this? We can also write this as ds square as dx1 square plus dx2 square plus dx3 square. Now let's ask how will it generalize to n dimensions. Okay, still Euclidean geometry, but suppose instead of having a 3-dimensional space, you have an n dimensional space. So in n dimensions, we have dx square as dx1 square plus dx2 square up to dxn square, okay, which you can also write using the summation symbol, sum I equal to 1 to n dxi square. So this is the rule of Euclidean geometry. Okay, this formula tells us how to calculate distance between two neighboring points. Now we generalize this to Riemannian geometry. So Riemannian geometry has a different rule for calculating the distance between two points, and that is ds square. Well, this summation symbol is familiar to everybody, right? This is sum from 1 to n. So in Riemannian geometry, the rule is that you sum over I and j equal to 1 to n gij of x. Okay, so I'll explain the symbol. So x vector just is a symbol that stands for these n coordinates together. So gij of x, what is this? So gij of x is a function of x1 to xn for every pair I and j. Okay, so g11 is some function of x1 to xn, g12 is some function of x1 to xn, and so on. And we can always choose without any loss of generality that gij is equal to ggi. Okay, because if gij as a matrix can be symmetric or anti-symmetric, or in general it's a linear combination of a symmetric matrix and an anti-symmetric matrix. But the anti-symmetric part will drop out because this product is symmetric. Okay? So for example, g12 dx1 dx2 plus g21 dx2 dx1. Okay? So you'll always get the combination of g12 plus g21. So we can from the beginning take gij to be symmetric. Every gij is equal to ggi. Yes. So the point is that suppose gij is a n by n matrix, then you can always write it as a sum of a symmetric matrix. I can always write it as a sum of a symmetric matrix and an anti-symmetric matrix. So Sij is Sgi and Aij is minus Agi. Any matrix can be written this way, right? Sum of a symmetric matrix and anti-symmetric matrix. Now, when you substitute Agi in this expression, we will get a combination of A12 dx1 dx2 plus A21 dx2 dx1. But dx1 dx2 is the same as dx2 dx1. So you will get a combination A12 plus A21, which is 0. So no, only the symmetric part will contribute anywhere. And so because of this, we can from the beginning take restrict Gij to be symmetric. So this is the general definition of what you mean by Riemannian geometry. Okay, that the distance between neighboring points is not simply dx1 square plus dx2 square plus dx3 square, etc., that you would normally expect in Euclidean geometry, but it's a more general notion of distance which is measured by this function. Is this point clear? We'll see some specific examples, okay, of Riemannian geometry as we go on. Now it should be also clear from here that Euclidean geometry is a special case of Riemannian geometry, right? Because how will you recover Euclidean geometry from here? Delta ij. So Euclidean geometry is corresponds to a choice when gij of x is delta ij. Delta ij is a Kronecker symbol, right? You are familiar with this. I, this is one if I is equal to j, okay, is zero otherwise. Okay, if I is not equal to j. So if you take g to be diagonal with all ones, right, then this reduces back to this formula over here. So Riemannian geometry in some sense is a generalization of Euclidean geometry.
So can it include negative distances also? And why is it so that?
Yeah, so it could include negative distances. Eventually we will be interested in Lorentzian signatures, so it will include negative distances. Mm-hmm. But for now let's consider it to be a positive distance. Okay.
But there is no restriction, by the way, for making it to be a negative or positive.
Well, when Riemann introduced, I mean, he had in mind of only positive distances. But when we apply it to general relativity, we will also allow negative distances. Right? So those will be measured by the eigenvalues of this matrix. Right? If all the eigenvalues are positive, right, then the distance is positive definite. But if some of the eigenvalues are negative, right, then it's not positive definite.
So as a geometry point of view, there is no restriction to have a positive or negative.
No. You can have Riemannian geometry with a negative signature. But we will have to use negative signature to describe general relativity. Now, given an n-dimensional space, we can have choose many different functions gij of x. Right? You can, this is one particular choice, Euclidean space. Okay? You can take some function gij of x. Now, given two different functions, different sets of functions gij of x, they generically will define different geometric spaces, okay, different Riemannian manifolds. So if you have one set of functions gij, okay, that gives a specific Riemannian manifold. Now you take a different set of functions, that will in general be a different Riemannian manifold. This is true generically, but not always. Okay, and we will see why it's not true always. Okay, sometimes it may happen that two different set of functions, they still have the same Riemannian manifold. And this happens if they are related by a coordinate transformation, okay, which is what we are going to discuss now. So imagine that you are given a metric like this, okay, so this is known as a metric, okay, the gij is what we commonly refer to as a metric, okay, because it measures distance. A different set of coordinates. x prime n. So what exactly do you mean by a different set of coordinates? What you mean is that these coordinates are just functions of these. Okay, some known functions, so that given x1 to xn, we can determine what these are, or vice versa. Given x prime 1 to x prime n, we can determine what x1 to xn. So this functional relationship takes the following form. So x prime 1 will be some function of x, which I will call f1 of x. X prime 2 will be f2 of x, and so on up to x prime n. And you also have its inverse relation, namely x1 can be written as g1 of x prime x2 is g2 of x prime and so on xn is gn of x prime. Okay, just new set of coordinates for the same value m c x. Yeah, this g is okay. Let me call it h. This g is okay. So h1, h2 up to hn. So imagine that you have two neighboring points. Okay, this we have called x, and this we have called x plus dx. Now suppose in a new coordinate system, okay, this x prime coordinate system, this point has coordinate x prime and this point has coordinate x prime plus dx prime by definition. Okay, so x prime 1 for example is given by h1 of x, or x prime 1 is given by f1 of x, x prime 2 is given by f2 of x and so on. Similarly, x prime 1 plus dx prime 1 is given by f1 of x plus dx, and so on. Then we have the relation that dxi is given by sum over k del xi del x prime k dx prime. Just chain rule, right? That how much, that if x prime changes by dx prime k, okay, how much does xi change? Okay, so that change is obtained by this rule. This is clear? The change of a function, xi after all is some function of the x prime 1 to x prime k. Okay. So the change in xi is given by, determined by how much x prime k changes. So given this, we can now see that this distance between the same two physical points, what does it look like in the x prime coordinate system? So ds square will now be given by sum over I j equal to 1 to n g I j of x. Then for dxi, I am going to substitute this over here, sum over k equal to 1 to n Now these are all finite sums. Okay, finite sums, the order of summation can be interchanged. Okay, so I can do these sums last, okay, and do this one first. So I can write this as sum over k and l to 1 to n, then sum over I j equal to 1 to n g I j of x del x I del x prime k del x j del x prime k Okay, just rearrange the terms. That was the action. Is this okay? So this quantity I declare, I call G prime K L of X prime. This is some quantity, right? Which has index K and L. Okay, I and J are of course some numbers, which has index K and L. So I call this quantity G prime K L of X prime. So I can write the metric as sum over K L equal to 1 to N G prime K L of X prime dx prime k dx prime l. But since k is a dummy index, I can also rewrite this as sum over ij equal to 1 to n g prime ij of x prime dx prime I dx prime Is this okay? So now we can see that G prime in general look a different, like a different function. Nevertheless, G prime and G, okay, these two sets of functions, describe exactly the same Riemannian space, because you can go from one to the other simply by change of coordinate system. Yeah, there is no intrinsic difference between these two different Riemannian manifolds. You can simply go from one to the other by just changing coordinates. Right? Whether you use x coordinate or x prime coordinate, the metric will appear as gij in one coordinate system and g prime ij in the other coordinate system. Is this clear? So g and g prime, gij and g prime ij describe same metric, same space, same Riemannian
manifold. So the inverse is also understood if G prime and G.
Yes.
Of two metric are related in this way, we can always say that it can be.
Exactly, that's right. Because that means that you can always change coordinates right, to go back. So let me now do some examples, okay, which will make things clearer. So first example I think is probably familiar to all of you. Okay, this is simply changing coordinates from Cartesian to polar. Okay, but let's see it in this slide. So Euclidean geometry, Euclidean metric as we have already written, is ds square is dx1 square plus dx2 square plus dx3 square. Now, choose new coordinates. R theta phi in the following way. So, x1 is R sine theta cos phi, the standard spherical polar coordinate system. X2 is R sine theta sine phi. R cos theta. So then we can apply this rule to find what the metric will look like in the R theta phi coordinate system. Or equivalently, what you can do is we can just simply express dx1 in terms of r theta phi, dx2 in terms of r theta phi, dx3 in terms of r theta phi, and substitute. Okay, so let me just write one of these equations and
leave the rest of the rest for you to do.
So, for example, dx1 will be given by
sine theta cos phi times dr plus r cos theta cos phi d theta minus r.
And similarly for dx2
and dx3.
Okay, and then at the end you can calculate ds square
as dx1 square plus dx2 square plus dx3 square.
And I leave it as an exercise to check that at the end what we'll get is dr square plus r square d theta square plus r square sine square theta phi square. Okay. So this means that in this r theta phi coordinate system we have grr is equal to 1. G theta theta is r square, G phi phi as r square cos square theta, and all other gi is 0. Otherwise, so you can call it G metric in the new
coordinate.
R square sine square. So what this tells us is that if we have a metric of this kind, okay, where gij is just diagonal 1, 1, 1 with everything else 0, that metric is equivalent to another metric where the metric is again diagonal when it's 1 r square sine square theta. Okay, these two metrics describe the same Riemannian manifold because you can go from one to the other by a change of coordinate. Is this clear? So this was a simple example, okay, of a Euclidean space. Now we will be describing a space that is not Euclidean, okay, where the usual rules of Euclidean geometry doesn't hold. So example of a non-Euclidean space. And again, this is something which is very familiar. due to the surface of a two-dimensional sphere. Okay, how do we describe the surface of a two-dimensional sphere? Okay, we can simply write an equation, x squared plus y squared plus z squared is equal to a squared. Okay, this is the surface of a two-dimensional sphere. So we could write the metric, the distance between two points on the sphere is still dx square plus dy square plus dz square, because that's the distance in three dimension, and we are restricted to move on this space. But that is not the most efficient way of describing a two-dimensional sphere, because if the sphere is two-dimensional, then it requires only two coordinates to specify the location of a point on the surface, right? Not three. Okay, three coordinates are not independent. So what you would want to do is to introduce two independent coordinates and write the expression for the metric, okay, distance between the two points, in terms of those two coordinates, not three coordinates the way you have written here. Okay, so let's see how we can do that. Okay. So you want to write. So goal is that introduce two coordinates
we are defining distance along the surface.
Mm-hmm. But if the points are infinitesimally close to each other, then the distance along the surface is the same as the Euclidean distance, right? Because you are calculating distance with two infinitesimally close points. Okay, so that's why you can still use this formula. Okay, if you have a distance between two diametrically opposite points, then of course the distance along the surface is not the same as the Euclidean distance, right? Because it's a question between the difference between diameter and the equator of the surface, right? Half equator of the surface. Those are clearly different. But when the points are very close to each other, then there is no difference between the distance measured along the surface of the sphere and the direct distance. Is this two points which are far away? Then this distance and this distance are not the same. But these two distances approach each other if we are taking points which are closer and closer. Okay, the difference between the distance measured along the arc and the distance measured along the chord goes to zero in the limit when the distance itself goes to zero. Okay, that is the reason why we can still use this formula. The formula, the ds square, let me write this formula. So ds square is equal to dx square plus dy square plus dz square. Okay, this formula is still valid. Even when the distance is measured along the surface of the sphere, because this is talking about infinitesimal distances. Okay, so the goal is that we introduce two coordinates on the surface of the sphere and express ds square in this system, in this coordinate system. So we'll describe two different ways of doing this. So the first method is the direct method. Okay, let me call this x1, x2, x3. X1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square. So the first method is to simply eliminate x3 using this equation. Okay? So x3, write x3 as plus minus square root of a square minus x1 square minus x2 square. And now you pick x1 and x2 as the independent coordinates. x3 is determined. But you have to now express ds squared in terms of x2 and x3 only. Okay, so dx squared, let me write it here. This was dx1 squared plus dx2 squared plus dx3 squared. But now you have to write it in terms of x1 and x2 only because these are the independent coordinates. So what you have to do is to express x3 back in terms of x1 and x2 using this relation. So this is dx1 squared plus dx2 squared plus x2. So dx3 will be minus x1 minus x2 dx2 divided by square root a squared. Square. Plus minus is there, but on the square it of course is square. Is this okay? Right? This is the differential of this. And then when you square it and add things up, what you get is 1 plus x1 square over a square minus x1 square. Times dx1 square plus 1 plus x2 square over and then have draw start with this 2 x1 x2 over Is this okay? I have just squared it and collected terms together. So from this we can read out the various components of the metric. We can read out that G11 is 1 plus x1 squared over square minus x1 square minus x2 square is equal to 1 plus x2 square over a square minus x1 square. And what about G12? How much is G12 from here? Yes?
X1, x2.
What? A square minus x1 square minus x2 square. Okay. This 2 goes away because there is a g12 dx1 dx2 plus g21 dx2 dx2. So this is one way of describing the surface of a two-dimensional sphere. Okay? This metric describes the metric on the surface of a two-dimensional sphere. Now let's look at the second method. So in this method, what you do is that we can first go to spherical polar coordinates. Okay? So go from x1, x2, x3 to r theta phi.
Square minus x1 square minus x2 square, and
yes.
We are talking about a sphere. Yes. Sum plus this x1 square plus x2 square mass go to S square.
Exactly, yeah.
Which will make this metric to
diverge. Diverge, exactly. So that basically means that this coordinate system is not good at that, around those points.
Hmm. How to see that without going into the coordinate system problem?
How to see that this is a
singularity not of the space, but it's a...
Yeah, so the point is, for that what you have, there are various ways to do that, right? One way is to look for another coordinate system which is good, in which the metric behaves correctly around this point. Yeah, that's what we'll do. Yeah, the second coordinate system that we'll be writing, right, we'll see that the metric behaves correctly. We have without any problem near these points, when x1 square to x2 square equal to s square. General method is the various methods. So another way is to explicitly find coordinate transforms which makes a metric non-singular around those points. Okay, so if you go to the r theta phi coordinate system, right, then what is the equation of a sphere in the r theta phi coordinate system?
R square equal to
s square, right? So the equation becomes simple, r square equal to s square or r equal to a. Okay, there is no plus minus because r is positive. And yeah, r is from 0 to infinity. And ds square, we calculated earlier, dr square plus r square d theta square plus r square sin square theta d phi square. So now, when you said r equal to a, dr goes away, and this becomes a square d theta square plus sin square theta d phi square. So the claim is that this metric and this metric, they still have the same physical space, same Riemann metric. And so there must be a coordinate transformation that takes you from one to here to there. So what is that coordinate transformation? What is the coordinate transformation that relates x1, x2 to theta phi? Yes? Yeah, because we already have determined the spherical coordinate, the relation between Cartesian and spherical coordinate, right? All you have to do is to evaluate those relations at r equal to a. Right? That will be. So, if we take x1 as a sin theta cos phi, right? I have substituted for r equal to a, and x2 as a sin theta sin phi. Okay. Take these two coordinates x1, x2 and substitute here. Okay, you will find that you recover this metric over here. Okay, so ds square that we wrote down, g11 dx1 square plus g22 dx2 square plus g12 2g12 dx1 dx2. Okay, start with that metric. Substitute for dx1 what you will get from here. Substitute for dx2 what you will get from here. And just evaluate the metric ds square. Right, and you will find that at the end of some long calculation, you recover the simple metric over here. So ds square of x1, x2 system is the same as ds square in the theta phi system. Okay, so this will be an exercise. Okay, to explicitly check that this is really the case. Okay, for the first 2 weeks, I have not given you homework. Okay, but please try to do all these things that I'm leaving behind. Okay, that because I'll in the tutorials we'll try to discuss some of these. So is the statement clear? What you have to check? Right? Take ds square in terms of x1, x2 coordinate system, substitute for x1 and x2 these expressions and show that you get back this expression what you have. Now here, of course, we are lucky because we have derived them, okay, from some three-dimensional matrix which is simple. But suppose we didn't know where they came from, somebody gave us these two matrix. Okay, one matrix given in terms of x1, x2, other matrix given in terms of theta phi. How do we conclude that these are the same Riemannian spaces? If we diagonalize. See, just diagonalizing is not going to help. Right? Because diagonalizing, you make a linear combination of x1 and x2, right? But that's not a transformation that takes you from theta phi. So that's just diagonalizing the matrix is not going to give you back the simple form. Okay, you have to do more work. Okay. So if we could show the straightforward method will be to say that okay, we want to find a coordinate transformation which takes you from here to here. But if somebody has given you these two matrix and asked you to answer the question whether these are the same matrix, right? You cannot look for infinite set of coordinate transformations and check for everyone, right? So you have to find some better method, okay, to decide whether these two matrix are the same or not. Okay. For example, suppose this matrix had this parameter A, right? And here I had to change the parameter from A to 2A. Suppose this is 4A squared times this. Okay. Are they the same matrix? Now this coordinate transformation, of course, doesn't take you here. Okay? That's clear. This coordinate transformation will give you this matrix. But how do you know that there is not another coordinate transformation which will give you 4a square instead of a square? Right? In principle, it could happen. Even a more basic question, how do you know that this matrix that you have written down is different from two-dimensional Euclidean matrix? dx1 square plus dx2 square. Okay. Could there be a coordinate transformation that take you from this to just dx1 square plus dx2 square? Right? Or dy1 square plus dy2 square or some y1, y2 which are functions of theta and phi. So clearly these are important questions because these are the questions that need to be answered to classify which Riemannian manifolds are distinct. Yeah, if you are given two Riemannian spaces, we want to know under what condition they are actually different spaces, yeah, or under what condition they are actually related by coordinate transformation. So as I said, the brute force method of course is inefficient, okay, and you will never be sure. I mean, if you have found a coordinate transformation that relates the two, you are sure that they are the same spaces. But if you have not managed to find a coordinate transformation that relates the two, yeah, you can never be sure that way that they are not the same. Yeah, because there could be some other coordinate transformation which could work. So the general strategy that one tries to follow here is to construct appropriate combinations is not invariant coordinate transformation that we have seen. But it could happen that some appropriate combinations of matrix and its derivatives will become independent of coordinate transformations, will become invariant under coordinate transformations. And then if we can find such quantities, then compare them. Thank you. and in that case, because these combinations, by definition, do not change under coordinate transformation. If their values are different between two different manifolds, we know for sure that the manifolds must be different. Right? Because any coordinate change that you make in one manifold, so we'll leave this quantity unchanged. So if this quantity is different in two different manifolds, they must be different. So in particular, for the two-dimensional space, we'll be able to construct a quantity out of the metric and its derivatives, whose value is A, this constant A. Okay? In this coordinate system as well as in this coordinate system. And that tells us that if we have two different manifolds, one with metric given by A, the other one with metric given by 2A, right? For which the metric is 4A squared times the same expression, then those two manifolds can never be related by coordinate transformation. Right? Because coordinate transformation leaves that particular quantity invariant.
Say the invariant quantities of two metrics are same, then can we conclude that they must be?
Yeah, so well, if there are sufficient number of invariant quantities which are the same, then the two metrics are will be the same. Yeah, but just one invariant quantity being same is not enough. Right? So for every, it depends on the dimension of the manifold and so on. But given a specific case, then you can see what are the things that you have to check to establish that they are the same. So now I'll introduce some conventions. Which have followed implicitly, but now I'll make it more explicit. The first convention is that for a coordinate, the index that I am using, I, will always be written as a superscript. So index I of a coordinate will be a superscript. So x sum. Then del del xi, okay, derivative with respect to a given coordinate, I'll write as just a subscript I attached to. Okay, so this is the definition. So del del xi. So del I by definition is del del xi. Then the third one is probably the most important convention, which is the summation convention. And that is the following, that any index appearing twice in a formula once as subscript and the other terms as superscript. Mm-hmm. is always sum. Okay, so we will not write the summation symbol explicitly, but it's understood that any index that appears twice, okay, is always sum. And this is useful because this allows us to drop many of the summation symbols, okay, from the formula. Okay, it's a convention, so it's not necessary. Okay, you could have written, you could have used coordinates with subscript notation. Okay, you could have used this also as subscript or superscript in the way you like. You need not have used summation convention because all of these are conventions. It's just that using these conventions, you can make the formula look simpler. Okay, and often we can use this convention. If you work in this convention, often you can check if your the validity of your formula by making sure that the indices are appropriately matched above and below. Okay, that whenever an index is repeated twice, it should never happen that the same index comes twice, but both as superscripts or both as subscripts. Okay, so follow the summation convention. It will always appear in a pair, once as superscript, one as subscript. So let me give the example for the other one also, which is the convention I have been following, is that for the metric, the index is a subscript. So let me add that. So let's see how this helps. First, let's look at the expression for the distance square, ds square, which was sum over ij equal to 1 to n gij of x dxi dxj. In this summation convention, I can write this simply as gij of x dxi dx. Why? Because the index I has appeared twice in this formula, once as subscript, once as superscript. Similarly, the index j has appeared once as subscript, once as superscript. So they are automatically summed over without having to tell that they are summed. Is this clear? So this is the first example. The second example is the transformation law of the metric. So what was the transformation law? G prime ij of x prime was sum ij equal to 1 to n g prime q n here. So this I can write as g I j of x del k prime of x I del l prime of x. Okay, again you see that I j index is summed over. Okay, automatically, because they are repeated index, one subscript, one superscript. The other thing you can notice from this formula is that the index, the free index, okay, which is not summed over, must match between the left hand side and right hand side. Okay? And if it's subscript on the left hand side, then it also appears as a subscript on the right hand side in this convention. Here you see that it's k as subscript, here also it's k as subscript. Mm-hmm. Is this okay? And finally, again, this is something useful to remember, okay, when you write down the transformation laws, that when you are writing transformation laws from x to x prime, then a given index, if it belongs to the prime variables, it must belong to prime variables on both sides. Okay. If it belongs to the unprime variable, it must belong to the unprime variable on both sides. Okay. Or when it's repeated twice, it must either both be part of a prime variable or both be part of an unprime variable. So let's see this k, index k. Okay. This is part of a prime variable, right? G prime. Okay. And you see that on this side, the index k is also a part of a prime variable. Okay. LL is x prime. LL x prime. Similarly for the index L. On the other hand, the index I is part of an unprime variable. Okay? It was original matrix, GIG. And it's contracted with XI, which is again an unprime variable. Is this clear? Okay, this rule is of course looks trivial here because after all this is the rule that we had derived, right? But this rule will be useful to keep in mind because when you write down general tensors, okay, it's easy to use these rules to figure out what the correct transformation of the tensors would be. Any questions? Now, I am going to introduce the notion of tensor fields. So, let's suppose some combination. Transform in a certain way. This transforms as follows. So A prime I1 to I Q of X prime. This should be related to in some way to A J1 to J Q of X.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, here derivatives means all derivatives of all orders.
Yes, derivatives could be derivatives of all orders, right? I mean, right now we are not saying restricted to any finite part derivatives. Some combination of metric and derivatives, right? We will see later how to construct such combinations. Okay, right now we are saying suppose you have been able to construct some combination of metric and derivatives which has certain transformation laws, right? So that when you change the coordinates, right? So the metric, you get a new metric G prime IJ. Right? You take the same combination, but now constructed out of G prime IJ. Okay? And the derivatives are now with respect to X prime I. Okay? So that's what we'll call A prime. Okay? And imagine that this combination has been constructed in such a way that A prime and A are related in a certain fashion. Okay? We'll supply what these missing terms are. Okay? But under that condition, we will say that A transforms as a tensor, okay, in particular as a covariant tensor. Now you want to put in these factors. So can you guess what these factors should be? Yes, del.
Okay.
Give me the first term. Del.
I one prime.
Del I one prime. X. I one prime.
X. X.
X J one. Up to del prime I cube of X J cube.